Take about 30 more seconds for you to find your seats. So every week I receive emails from parents, from young people, a lot of times questioning things, you know, how do we explain this, what about this, or how did this happen? I want to share with you as we begin this next hour an email that I received from a young man by the name of Cody. He said, "Dr. Brad, I've been attending the Church of Christ all my life. I've been a member since I was 12. I'm 21 now, and I'm really having some problems with doubt." He said, "I've talked to you a few times before, but I know I've never just come completely clean and admitted the fact that I'm really having a hard time with this. What do I do?" Now, the reason that Cody's email stands out to me a little bit differently is because Cody has been to preaching school. He's a preacher. And yet, this young man, he's struggling with doubt. Part of the reason why he is still struggling with doubt, even after having gone to preaching school, having a pulpit to preach from, is he's been indoctrinated with so much stuff. His head is just kind of filled. He's wondering, is there any possibility that some of this stuff is true? Like, for instance, he was told that all life evolved from creatures like the one you see on the screen behind me, trilobites. Allegedly, these guys lived 500 to 600 million years old. Most scientists call them index fossils, meaning anywhere that you find a trilobite in the dirt, by definition, you're supposed to be in a layer that's 500 to 600 million years old. They date these things at the bottom of their geologic column. Now, why is that a big deal? It's a big deal because in 1969, a guy by the name of William Meister and his friends were out looking for trilobite fossils. They had scaled up a little ledge in Antelope Springs, Utah. They had their little rock hammers. They were tapping open rocks. Well, Meister found one. He hit it. It split open. And he found two trilobites in the sandal print of a human. Now, folks, that's a problem. The reason I say that's a problem is because we're supposedly separated from these things by roughly 595 million years. And yet, you've got two trilobites in the sandal print of a human. Now, I've seen it. I actually had them take it out of a lockbox in Texas because I'd been told that you could see the sandal stitching on this thing. There's no getting around it. It is exactly what they say. It is a sandal print with trilobites in it. The guy who owns it, he told me, he said, "Brad, I've been offered over $1 million by evolutionists who've told him all they want to do is destroy it." And yet, you got evidence that Cody's never seen. Or how about this one? Textbooks filled with examples like these, where you've got these embryos that they say prove evolution. Now, just to kind of orient you for just a moment, if you look at the bottom left-hand side of the screen, you'll notice you've got a fish, a salamander, a turtle, a chicken, pig, couple of mammals, and finally a human. In three different embryological states of development. But if you look across that top row, they basically all look the same, don't they? And they were drawn that way on purpose. The guy who drew them, his name was Ernst Haeckel. He believed in evolution. In fact, he said the turning point in his thinking was when he read Charles Darwin's book. In fact, those of you who really know your history, you know that Ernst Haeckel actually visited Charles Darwin at his home there on the mount. So they basically talk together. They both believe in this idea of a common ancestor. He draws these drawings, and lo and behold, they were completely forged. They were made up. And so, Ernst Haeckel, he was fired from the University of Jena. He was convicted of scientific fraud. And you say, what's the big deal? Okay, that happened back in the 1800s, and yet we're still using his pictures today. Oh, we've colorized them. We've made them prettier, but the fact of the matter is, they're still in your kids' textbooks because they sell the picture that they want to sell. On the screen behind me, you'll notice across the top is Haeckel's drawings. At the bottom is the real McCoy. And yet you'll notice they don't look a whole lot alike, do they? The reason why they don't show that picture in your kids' textbooks is because it doesn't sell the idea that we all evolved from a common ancestor. Interestingly, there was an evolutionist, very well-known one, a guy by the name of Stephen Jay Gould, who used to write for Natural History Magazine, and he actually addressed these embryos. He wrote an article called Atrocious, where he rebuked evolutionists for continuing to use this evidence that was false. Listen to what he says. He said, "We should therefore not be surprised that Haeckel's drawings entered the 19th century textbooks. But we do, I think, have the right to be both astonished and ashamed by the century of mindless recycling that has led to the persistence of these drawings in a large number, if not majority, of modern textbooks." A century of mindless recycling? Yeah, we're still using them. Last night, one of the young men actually brought up another one, vestigial structures. The idea that we've got all of these leftover parts, and you'll notice on this particular textbook it says, vestigial structures are remnants of an organism's evolutionary past. You go back to 1931, 180 alleged vestigial organs. The tonsils, the appendix, the pineal gland, the thyroid, all of these different things. And yet, that list has been completely wiped out today because we know that they have a true function. In fact, here's the sad thing. We know they still have a function, and yet we're still using them as evidence for evolution. In fact, this textbook, I love this. You've got those fake embryos over here on the right, you got vestigial structures on the left, both of which are total hoaxes. And yet this is supposed to be proof of evolution. I mentioned a scenario where we learned about the appendix. And you notice this is a textbook from 1989. They're still touting vestigial structures. And they talk about the appendix being a vestigial structure. You fast forward to the year 1994. You've got the appendix of a human beside that of a horse. And then lo and behold, 1998, Grolier's Encyclopedia says, "Long regarded as a vestigial organ with no function in the human body, the appendix is now thought to be one of the sites where immune responses are initiated. Its removal increases a person's susceptibility to leukemia, Hodgkin's disease, cancer of the colon, and cancer of the ovaries." Oh, you mean it had a function? Yeah. I was doing a debate down in New Zealand with a surgeon. His name was Dr. Joe, and during the middle of the debate, I actually set him up and got him to admit that there was design in the human body. And as soon as he let it out of his lips, he realized what he'd said. And he crawfished on me. He said, but the human body's got all these vestigial organs. That's proof that evolution is true. Now, this is a 3-hour televised debate. So I looked at him. I looked at the cameras and I said, "You know, Dr. Joe, you've had medical training. I've had medical training. How about we do this? How about we take these television cameras into a sterile operating suite and I'll cut out all of your vestigial organs?" He didn't want to do that. And the reason he didn't want to do that is because deep down he knows they have a function. In fact, R.L. Wysong, he put it beautifully. He said, not too long ago, man was imputed to have 180 vestiges. Organs like the appendix, the tonsils, the thymus, the pineal gland, thyroid gland, they were all on the list. He said, today, all former vestigial organs are known to have some function during the life of the individual. If an organ has any function at any time, it cannot be called rudimentary or vestigial. He says, as man's knowledge has increased, the list of vestigial organs has decreased. So what really was vestigial? Was it not man's rudimentary knowledge of the intricacies of the body? In other words, just because we don't know what something does, it doesn't mean that's a leftover byproduct of evolution, folks. Maybe what we ought to do is humble ourselves and realize we don't know everything. But here's the problem that I see in the church. By the age of five, if you got a five-year-old child, grandchild, they've already been indoctrinated by the evolutionary theory. And the reason that I say that is because there's not too many five-year-olds that are not absolutely enthralled with the dinosaurs. Kids absolutely love them. I mean, you think about it for just a moment. They buy the figurines, the toys. When my middle son was just 2 years of age, for the life of him, he could not say the words apple juice. Okay, he said it with a Z. It was apple juice. I remember very distinctly sitting on a couch with this two-year-old looking at a book of dinosaurs and him pointing them out going, oh, Dad, look, there's an apatosaurus, a brachiosaurus, a spinosaurus. Could you give me some apple juice? I'm like, kids love them. I tell parents, if you haven't stepped on a dinosaur figurine in the middle of the night, you're not qualified yet as a parent, okay? But it's not just children that love them. We adults also love them. And as a result, magazines, they are quick to put their picture on the cover because they know when they do that, they're almost guaranteed increased sales. And so they'll tell us where they were found, where they were discovered, how big they think they were, what they believe they ate. Like, for instance, the largest dinosaur ever discovered up until just a few short years, months ago, is a creature called the Argentinosaurus. They estimate this guy at 110 tons. That's roughly about 12 to 13 African elephants in size. In fact, if you want to see him, to my knowledge, the only place that has a full-size replica is in the Fernbank Museum in Atlanta, Georgia, where he stretches literally from one end of the museum to the next. Now, to give you a perspective of how big this guy is, if you look at the screen on the right-hand side right here, that's a full-size T-Rex that doesn't come up to this guy's hip bone. He was huge. And yet, moms and dads, it's because of these same dinosaurs that we're losing a lot of our children. Because by age five, they know their names. They know all these facts about them. And if I were to ask your young people today, when did the dinosaurs walk on the earth? You know what the immediate gut response is for most young people, including Christian young people? Millions of years ago. And so in their minds, they've already associated dinosaurs walking this earth long before man was ever here. Okay, folks, if that's true, somebody help me harmonize that with this. You can't. So here's what we're going to do. Let's walk through the life of a young person here at Boonville for just a moment. We'll start at age two, three, where, for instance, they buy all kinds of games, figurines, all kinds of toys. In fact, some of you grandparents, you are guilty of filling up the houses with these. They get a little bit older. Maybe they're four or five. It's November in Mississippi. It's a cool morning. Mom is over there. She's stirring up instant oatmeal. All the while, your child is reading the bag, learning about evolution. They get older, 5, 6, and all of a sudden they're snacking all the time. All they want to do is eat snacks, and so what do? We give them snacks, and they learn about evolution. The day comes, they finally hit about 7. They're old enough finally to take them to a fine dining establishment. Okay, so you load them up in the car, you go somewhere nice like Wendy's. Until I have 4 children, right? In fact, you go through the drive-thru. They're sitting in the back eating their chicken nuggets. All the while, they're reading their Happy Meal bag, learning about what? Evolution. Or maybe your child doesn't like Wendy's. Maybe they like Arby's. Where, again, they're learning about evolution. Okay, now they get older. Now they hit about 9, 10, and they start taking field trips. Field trips here in Mississippi or maybe up to Memphis, where they start looking at some of these museums where things are allegedly hundreds of millions of years old. Or maybe they take off to the Smithsonian in Washington, D.C. Or maybe they head out to the Fern Bank there in Atlanta. Or maybe they go to Chicago to the Field Museum where Sue, that massive Tyrannosaurus Rex, is on display. Now, just as a real quick side note, I want you to take a look at that picture and ask yourself, how many of the parents of those children in that picture do you think honestly thought about what their children would be reading on those placards when they signed the permission slip for them to take that field trip? Because I took that picture. And I also took the picture of what those placards say. And folks, there's no way to harmonize those placards with God's Word. They get a little bit older. Now they're 11, 12. They start reading chapter books. In fact, let me see a show of hands. How many young people in this room, how many of you are familiar with the Magic School Bus? Raise your hand real high. Oh, we got some older readers in this room. Really popular kids series. In fact, in this particular book, you'll notice you open it up, and the little boy, he's got a picture of a dinosaur chasing a caveman. Notice what it says. This story is make-believe. His friend says, yeah, there were no dinosaurs in the time of cave people. In fact, top left-hand corner says no people ever saw a dinosaur. When early humans appeared on the earth, dinosaurs had already been dead for millions of years. People found out about dinosaurs from fossils. Or maybe your child doesn't like the Magic School Bus. Maybe they like the Magic Treehouse, another very popular kids series. This one, you don't even get into the main book yet. I mean, you're literally still in the introduction. And you'll notice this says, it talks about dinosaurs living millions of years ago. Then it says, human beings, of course, had not yet what? Evolved. Right about now, there's a couple of you parents in this room thinking, oh no, I didn't even look at their books. You didn't even think about the fact that they've been digesting stuff that is antithetical to God's Word. By the way, in this one, right in the middle, remember that geologic column that we just kind of dismantled? They've got it. Now, they flipped it sideways, but you'll notice they've got dinosaurs coming in, and then finally right at the end, there we are. Again, can't harmonize that with God's Word. They get older, 13, 14. Now they're taking science classes, physical science. Maybe they come home one semester, they're having to take botany and learn about plants and biology. And one semester they come home with a book that's titled Evolution, Change Over Time. Now, if I were to ask you, do you think there's any possibility they use dinosaurs in this book to try to communicate or teach evolution? Like, if we were to open it up, and we look on page 10, page 16, page 25, page 28, page 29, page 36, page 38, page 39, page 46, page 66, page 96, 97, page 98, 99. In fact, in a 100-page textbook, roughly a third of them have pictures or discussion about these creatures. Now, just to make sure we're all on the same page and we all understand what the dilemma is, here's what's going on. Right now, our kids are being told that dinosaurs died out roughly 65 million years ago, and that we came along carrying our clubs roughly 3 million years ago. And yet, the Bible paints a totally different picture, doesn't it? If I were to ask you, what day does the Bible say all land-dwelling creatures were created on? The answer? Day 6. What day does the Bible say man was created on? Day 6. We talked last night about the fact that these days are literal days. They're not millions of years. So you know what that would mean? That means they had to be created on the same day. That means that man had to coexist with them. So the real question is not, did they exist? The real question is what? When? You see, we know dinosaurs walked this earth. We have found their fossilized remains on all 7 continents. Arctic to Antarctic and everywhere in between. I had a buddy who called me about 6 months ago. He had just gotten back from Antarctica. Guess what they found? Dinosaur fossils. I was coming back from a trip out in Oregon. Got a call from a preacher friend. He said, Brad, we need you to come to our building. I thought he meant to speak. He said, no, we got bones. I'm like, I'm thinking, okay, I've heard of people passing snakes. Not bones. Sure enough, I showed up. They were digging a massive elevator shaft. They're putting on a whole new wing for educational building. They were adding an elevator. In the bottom of this hole, there were all kinds of bones. We spent literally hours digging them out, measuring them, taking pictures. I tell people, and I'm not really kidding, in my computer, I've got probably hundreds of pictures of these bones. You don't think there's dinosaurs in the church? I got pictures of them, okay? It's not a question of if they existed. Question of when. How important is this question to evolutionists? Take a look at this quote. This kind of, to me, this pulls back the curtain. Philip Kitcher said, solid evidence for the coexistence of dinosaurs and humans would shake the foundations of evolutionary theory because, of course, the dinosaurs are supposed to have been long extinct by the time hominids or early man arrived on the scene. I want everybody in this room to remember that. Solid evidence of humans coexisting with dinosaurs would shake the foundation of their theory. Because I'm going to show you some of that evidence tonight. Evidence you're not going to see in your normal child's textbook or here on television. You're not going to hear it from National Geographic. In fact, there's a reason why every time you pick up something about dinosaurs, it starts out reminding you these creatures lived millions of years ago. But if I were to ask you, what's the truth about them? Let me give you about a 1 minute quick history lesson before I show you some evidence. The word dinosaur itself was actually coined in the year 1845. 1845, a guy by the name of Sir Richard Owen, he actually used two words, dinos, soros, both Greek words. He combined them together, the meanings of which were fearfully great lizard. 1845, I want you to remember that. Just put that up there somewhere. 1845, we come up with the word dinosaur, and since that time, we've kind of been fascinated with them. Did they live millions and millions of years ago? Or is it possible that they coexisted with us? Let's look at some evidence together. We'll start January 2005 when American researchers very quietly announced that they had discovered a dinosaur in the belly of a mammal. Now you say, so what? Who cares? Well, remember the evolutionary timeline. Mammals weren't supposed to come into the picture until way afterwards. In fact, mammals were supposedly evolving from the dinosaurs, and yet you got a mammal that was eating one. That kind of messes up their timeline, right? Or how about this? Where they've got skin from a hadrosaur that's actually pliable. Notice what I'm saying. It's not like fossilized rock. This is actual skin, pliable enough. They're actually now trying to get the color from it. Or maybe you could explain to me these Mesopotamian cylinder seals. Dug up out of the ground, look an awful lot like what you and I would call an apatosaurus. Or while we're down there digging, maybe somebody could explain to me these tablets. They were discovered over in Egypt. They're attributed to one of the kings, Narmer, the legendary first pharaoh of a united Egypt. And oh, by the way, they've got dinosaur-like creatures on them. Or maybe you could explain to me the Ica stones of Peru. A gentleman by the name of Dr. Javier Cabrera was given one of these stones as a birthday gift. He noticed it had these elegant carvings on it. So he asked the guy who gave it to him as a birthday present, he said, "Where did you get this?" It was a native farmer. He said, "Well, these are from the Incan tombs." He said they used to bury these in their tombs. Well, Dr. Cabrera set out to find as many of these ancient burial stones as he could find. He began to literally dig up the tombs. He would find the dead people right beside these Ica stones. All told, he found about 11,000 of them. Roughly a third of them have very elegant pictures of dinosaurs. But not just dinosaurs. In many cases, they actually have dinosaurs and men. In fact, take a look at this lower right-hand corner. You see a guy, he's dressed in Incan garb. He's got a spear. What's he doing? He's hunting it. Or maybe somebody could explain this one to me. Uncovered about 7 years ago, 800-year-old Buddhist temple, completely covered over in vegetation. Folks, this one, you can't fake. They came in with what you and I would call industrial strength roundup. Killed all the vegetation, pulled it all back, realized they had this elegant temple right there in the jungle. They turned it into basically a tourist trap. And when they pulled all this vegetation back, they noticed these elegant carvings all throughout the temple. Like, for instance, this top guy right up here, that's a monkey. If you look carefully, you'll notice his face, his front legs, his back legs, his tail actually kind of going up behind his head. The one down here on the bottom right, some of you may have on your wall at home, that's a deer. You see his antlers, his tail in the up position. But the artist didn't just stop with monkeys and deer. He also carved things like dinosaurs. In fact, dinosaurs so well constructed, a 10-year-old can tell me what kind it is. That's a stegosaurus. Now, here's the beautiful part. So, I've been trained as a scientist, first-hand information. I had a buddy of mine, he was going over to Cambodia. I said, "Look, you got to get me some first-hand pictures of this." So he did. He actually went, he took the tour. These are actually his pictures. He told me, he said, "Brad, I'm taking this tour. I'm snapping shots. We get to one of the columns that's got dinosaurs on it. I'm taking pictures for you." I turned to the tour guide and I asked him, "How do you explain this?" He said, the tour guide's exact words were, "I know what you're thinking, but I'm supposed to tell you it's a porcupine." Okay, I've seen porcupines before. That don't look like a porcupine. Or maybe somebody could explain to me the dinosaur figurines from Akabaro. Guy riding on the back of a horse. He looked down, he found the first of these ceramic figurines. They started digging. They found an entire culture used to live there. They found over 30,000 of these little figurines. They decided that they would have them dated. So they sent off a little piece of a tail, little piece of a foot to two labs here in the United States. Both labs came back with dates of roughly 2000 BC. Now, here's the interesting part. When they called the labs, they said, hey, you know that material we're sending you? It's coming from dinosaur figurines. Guess what both labs did? They withdrew their results, said, we're sorry, we're unable to give you any accurate readings on your material. Well, in 1990, we caught them, so to speak. 1990, we sent some dinosaur bone off to the University of Arizona. We didn't tell them it was dinosaur bone. We just said, hey, can you date this material? So using their methods in this blind study, they came back and said, it's about 9,000 years old. I grant you that's not 6,000 years old, right? But that's a far cry from 65 million. Or maybe somebody could explain to me. This child's poncho that a buddy of mine, Dennis Swift, discovered, the tomb of about 11-year-old boy whose mom had embroidered dinosaurs on it. Or maybe you could explain to me the petroglyphs in Natural Bridges National Monument. If you were to go there today, just outside of Blanding, Utah, there are three of these natural sandstone bridges, one of which they call Kachina. And it's on that particular sandstone bridge that the Anasazi Indians, they carved all kinds of things. You can go there today, you can see things like bighorn sheep, and you can see things like dinosaurs. In fact, take a look at the quote under this picture. It's from a guy by the name of Fran Barnes. He's a recognized authority on rock art in the American Southwest. He's also an evolutionist. He said, there's a petroglyph in Natural Bridges National Monument that bears a striking resemblance to a dinosaur. Why didn't he just call it a dinosaur? Because solid evidence of humans coexisting with dinosaurs would shake the foundation of their theory. It's interesting, on that same bridge, there's people carved, there's all kinds of like pterodactyls, things that supposedly shouldn't be together. Or maybe you can explain to me this textile that is in the Museum of Peru, aged about 400 to 700 AD, identified as a dinosaur. Or maybe you could explain to me the tomb of Richard Bell. If you ever get over to England, let me encourage you, go up north through what's called the Lake District. There's a little city called Carlisle. And right in the middle, there's this beautiful cathedral. It's actually older than the United States. And the reason I can say that, this guy died in 1496. He's not the oldest one buried there. 1496. Now, when did I say the word dinosaur was actually coined? 1845. So in round numbers, this guy died like 350 years before the word dinosaur even came into existence. And if you have them roll up that carpet you see right there at the bottom of the screen, or if you got four young children that don't know they're supposed to do it and they do it for you, you get down on your hands and your knees and you start looking, you'll see things like fish and dogs carved into the brass and things like dinosaurs. 350 years before the word ever came into existence. Or maybe somebody could explain to me this Mayan vase. It's clearly got a dinosaur on it. Or maybe you can really help me with this one. Because I see a three-toed dinosaur track very clearly, but the problem is it's got a human track in it. Oh, by the way, this one, verified by CT scan, showing that they're in the same layer. Or maybe somebody could explain to me these textiles from the Nazca tombs. Again, with dinosaur-like creatures. Or maybe you can help me understand all of the bones that you find in the Dinosaur National Monument, hundreds upon hundreds have been slammed into limestone rock. It's funny, you go there and they've got a mural that says, a seasonal flood caused this. I'm thinking, yeah, if you want to call the global flood seasonal. Because some of these things, 80 tons? Or maybe you could explain to me the discovery, Dr. Samuel Hubbard. Dr. Samuel Hubbard, he believed that the American Indians had been on this continent much longer than we were giving them credit. So here's what he did. He set out with an expedition into the Grand Canyon. And he was looking for things like their pottery, their clothing. Eventually, he made his way down the Havasupai Canyon. And he found his proof. He was right. He found their clothing. He found their pottery. But he also found their cave art. Etched into those canyon walls, there were images that had taken men hours to carve out. He says this. He says, taken all in all, the proportions are good. The huge animal is depicted in the attitude in which man would most likely see it, reared on its hind legs, balancing with a long tail, either feeding or in a fighting position, possibly defending itself against a party of men. Now, he wrote about it. It's called the Doheny Scientific Expedition. He actually published this. It's kind of been buried now. They're trying to get rid of it. But I brought a picture of exactly what he found. I hate to be the one to tell you. That right there, that's not a sheep. It's not a cow. But it's an awfully good representation of a dinosaur we now know existed called the Edmontosaurus. Again, how would they know what to carve if they had not seen this thing? Or maybe you can explain to me the soft tissue that started showing up here lately. This is in 2005. Mary Schweitzer's team discovered this one. I actually communicated with her. She was in a dinosaur dig in the Hell Creek Formation in Montana. And she told me, she said, Brad, it was really kind of a serendipitous event. She said, we found the femur of a T-Rex. Big bone. She said, we had encased it in a protective material. We're trying to get it back to the lab. So they rented a helicopter. The helicopter landed on site. She said, when we went to put this femur into the helicopter, we realized it was too big. The block of material would not fit. She said, we realized we were going to have to cut it right down the middle. When we did so, we could look inside this bone where we found soft tissue, blood vessels, and what she thinks are blood cells. And folks, I don't care. You ask any molecular biologist worth their salt at all, they're going to tell you soft tissue, blood vessels, blood cells, they don't stick around for 65 million years. So I asked her the one question that I thought was kind of obvious. I said, why do you think we've never found soft tissue in dinosaur bones before? Her answer sent a chill right up my spine. She said, maybe because we've never thought to look. You see, always before, the bone was the prize. You found a bone, that was a big deal. Can you imagine going up to an archaeologist saying, hey, I'd like to cut open your bone and dissolve it. See what's inside it. No, the bone was the prize. Since her discovery, we've actually found soft tissue in 7 additional dinosaur finds. And it's getting worse. Evolutionists, they're having a hard time. Because how do you explain soft tissue in something that supposedly died out millions and millions of years ago? You can't. Last November, I had a chance to take my family out to the Hell Creek Formation. We were doing a dinosaur dig for a DVD. If you ever want to see dinosaur fossils, this is where you need to go. Okay, this is like the mecca for dinosaur fossils. I'd called ahead. We had actually gotten permission from a dear lady. Her name was Marge. I told her, I said, look, I don't believe dinosaurs have been on this earth millions of years. What we're wanting to do is film something. She started laughing. She says, oh, I know they haven't. She said, I got proof. Come on out. So we did. She has 10,000 plus acres of land, dinosaur fossils all over them. I mean, I was just ecstatic. So we're out there, and Marge is one of those people who's been collecting all her life. She's got a better museum than some of the museums. We'd walk along, and she would point, and she'd say, there's one. And sure enough, we'd get down with our paintbrushes and little trowels, and we'd start cleaning it up, and there'd be a dinosaur bone. And by the end of the day, she had my children to where they could walk by and go, look, Dad, there's one. I'm like, this is awesome. While we're there, we actually were traveling from one site to the next. We load up in a couple of Suburbans. We got all our camera gear, all of our digging gear. And we're driving down, and she points over, and she said, you see that ridge over there? I said, yeah. She said, that's where Mark found his Triceratops horn. Okay, now I'm in Montana. I'm sitting there thinking to myself, I know God is amazing, but there's no way she's talking about the same Mark that I know. And I just looked at her. I said, you're not talking about Mark Armitage, are you? She said, yeah, that's where he found his Triceratops, right over there. And my head is just exploding. I looked at her. I said, seriously, the same guy who got fired from the University in California because he reported... She said, yeah, he found it right there. I was like, can we go? So we did. We turned the cars over. We go through fields. I'm just like beaming, literally. Got pictures of where this horn was. You know, we're snapping shots. We decided, hey, let's do a little piece of the DVD right here. While we're there, Marge looks at me. She goes, I got his phone number if you want to call him. It's like, are you kidding? So I called him. I said, Mark, so you don't know me. I said, my name is Brad Harab. I'm a creationist. I don't believe dinosaurs have been here millions of years. He starts laughing. He says, you and me both, brother. He said, I got the goods on it. I said, well, here's the deal. We're doing a DVD. I would love to interview you. Is there any way that... He said, tell you what. I'm doing a presentation in California on this date. If you can be out here, I'll give you all the time you want. So what do? We loaded up. We flew out, and we met with Mark. Mark's an interesting guy. He worked as a microscopist for 30 years. 30 years. So this guy, he spends some time looking under microscopes. He finds soft tissue in a Triceratops horn. He writes it up, never mentions God, never mentions creation, never mentions evolution. But because he wrote there was soft tissue in this Triceratops horn, he was laid off, fired. The university didn't want that. So while we're there, he actually brought a microscope, some of the tissue with me. Folks, it's amazing. He showed me tissue that you could literally, it was stretchable. He told me, he said, Brad, I've got osteocytes that two laboratories, they're wanting to culture. Okay, let me make sure you understand what he's saying. That means they think that they are viable enough that they can grow the tissue and divide and grow at... By the way, Mark has found soft tissue in two additional discoveries after his Triceratops horn. I mean, we're now pulling proteins out of T-Rex bones. I promise you, I could stand up here for a long time and just click away and show you picture after picture after picture that proves, yeah, we coexisted with these things. And yet, sadly... most of these young people will never, ever see this information. Somebody says, all right, if that's true, Brad, why aren't they mentioned in this book? And to that I would say, that's not a fair question. And the reason I say that's not a fair question, when did I tell you the word dinosaur was actually coined? 1845. When was your Bible translated into English? I give you a hint. King James Version, 1611. Okay, how do you get a word in a book in 1611 if that word doesn't come into actually existence until 1845? A better question would be for you to ask me this evening, is there compelling evidence of dinosaur-like creatures in this book? And to that I would say, take your Bible and turn with me to the book of Job. I'll point out, you can find these creatures in the book of Isaiah. And so, in fact, that's your homework tonight. Take a look in Isaiah and the book of Psalms. You can find these creatures. I love Job. The very first chapter of Job, we're introduced to a guy who's smitten with all kinds of trials. He's got probably what I would consider to be the most supportive wife you've ever met in your life. Take a look at verse 9 of chapter 2. After losing his wealth, his flocks, his children, he's covered in boils. His wife turns to him and says, "Do you still hold fast to your integrity? Curse God and die." That's a really supportive spouse for you. Thankfully, he doesn't do that, right? Because what happens next is his three friends come on the scene. Now, I put them in quotes because they're not really what you and I would call friends. What they really are, they're nosy. They're busybodies. They want to know what Job did. They assume he sinned big time, and they want to know what he did. So for the next 25 chapters in your Bible, here's what you're going to read. You read this dialogue between Job and these three guys. Now, obviously I'm paraphrasing, but it kind of goes something like this. Okay, Eliphaz steps up and says, "Wow, Job, you need to repent. Look at your life. You've offended God. What did you do?" Job says, "I didn't do anything." Friend number two tags in. Bildad tags in and says, "Ah, come on now, Job. We're your friends. You can tell us. What did you do?" He says, I didn't do anything. Friend number three, Zophar, steps up and says, "Ah, come on now, Job. You have offended Almighty God. What did you do?" And to which finally, in a fit of anger, Job burst out and he requests to speak to God. In fact, look at how he phrases it in Job chapter 13, verse 22. He says, "Then you call and I will answer, or let me speak and you respond to me." He's basically telling God, "You can go first or I'll go first." Well, in Job chapter 38, we have God's response. "The Lord answered Job out of the whirlwind and said, 'Who is this who darkens counsel by words without knowledge? Now prepare yourself like a man. I will question you and you will answer me.' And all of a sudden, here's what happened. Job was reminded he's not God. In fact, if you've never read Job 38, 40, 41, you need to go home and read those. Very humbling text. He starts barraging Job with a series of questions. He says, "Hey, Job, where were you when I laid the foundation of the earth? Job, where's the dwelling place of light? Hey, Job, how do I make snow and hail? Or you see the eagle and the hawk? How do they fly, Job? Or Job, what about the behemoth?" Job chapter 40, verse 15. "Look now at the behemoth which I made along with you. He eats grass like an ox. See now his strength is in his stomach muscles. He moves his tail like a cedar." What in the world? What's a behemoth? Somebody says, "Well, Dr. Brad, I'm glad you're with us this weekend because my Bible tells you. I got a little footnote that says it's either an elephant or a hippopotamus." Okay, well, I would politely remind you, your footnotes are not inspired, right? But I'll go along with you for a minute. Let's look at the description of this creature. It says, "His strength is in his loins, the force is in the navel of his belly." So obviously this is a guy with a large stomach, right? That guy have a big belly? Yep. That guy have a big belly? Yep. That guy have a big belly? Yep. Keep reading. Job chapter 40, verse 17. "He moveth his tail like a cedar. The sinews of his stones are wrapped together." Now friends, when it's talking about cedars here, it's going to be talking about some of the largest of trees. You say, "Brad, how do you know that?" Well, we do a little word study in the Bible. You remember it was the cedars of Lebanon that were used to build the temple? Remember that? These were massive. And yet, here's God describing this creature. He says, "He moves his tail like a cedar. Let me ask you, that look like a cedar to anybody in this room? Not exactly. How about that? Not exactly. That's getting a whole lot closer, isn't it? I love logical young people. Here's the problem. You look at that and you say, okay, that does make sense, Brad, but Job was a post-flood book. And by that, we mean this. We think it's one of the very first books of the Bible that was written, but the events of Job actually happen after the flood. So you're going to tell us God created man and dinosaurs on day six. Yep. And then we read about this behemoth. Oh, and chapter 41 talks about another creature called the Leviathan. We read about these creatures in Job. Wouldn't that mean... Yep. They had to be on that boat. Now, before you buy me one of those nice white jackets that ties in the back, give me just a moment to explain some things. I'll tell you guys, and I'm not exaggerating, I love the flood, okay? If my wife were sitting right here, she would tell you, I can talk 3 hours nonstop. If I have a bottle of water, I can talk 3 hours about the flood. I love it that much. I went back about 3 years ago, restudied it myself, found a bunch of new hidden nuggets and it's great. I'm not going to talk for 3 hours, I promise. I am going to point out a couple things. Number one, do you think that a God who can create the animals knows how big an ark he needs? Yeah. Number two, some of you have never thought about this one. Did Noah have to take adult animals on the boat? Could he have taken juveniles? Well, let's think about that. What were the animals used for after they got off the boat? To replenish the earth, right? So it makes sense you want to have animals that have a long reproductive life ahead of them, right? I mean, think about it. They take up less room, eat less food, produce less waste. Well, what does a dinosaur come from? An egg, right? Largest dinosaur egg we've ever discovered would fit very cleanly in both of my hands. Now, I don't think there were any animals getting on that boat holding an AARP card. I don't think it happened. So as you think about that, here you've got these animals that, lo and behold, is it possible God allowed? Yeah, I think it's possible. Then the last question that we have to deal with before I answer your questions this evening, what happened to them? Now, I wish that I could just basically wrap up my talk by saying, well, you know, all the dinosaurs died out because of blank, and give you an answer. But the reality is we don't know for sure. And I don't have a problem looking at each one of you saying, we don't know for sure. There's a lot of things, by the way, we don't know for sure. In fact, I think it's kind of nice occasionally to hear people say, you know what, we don't know. I will point out a couple things that some of you have never maybe put together. Like, for instance, what's the only animal on the planet that continues to grow throughout its lifespan? It's not humans. In fact, you think about it, humans, we have like a growth period, then we plateau, and then we shrink at the end, right? All animals do the exact same thing except reptiles. Reptiles, as long as a reptile is growing, alive, it's gonna keep growing. Now, you mix that scientific fact in with how old were people living prior to the flood? Well, let's see. Adam lived 930, Methuselah 969. How big do you think a Komodo dragon can get in 900 years? That's something to think about. Somebody says, well, but Brad, you still haven't explained how man can coexist with them. Take your Bible, open it up to Genesis chapter 1. Look with me at verses
29 and 30. Genesis 1, verse 29 and 30. God said, "See, I have given you every herb that yields seed, which is on the face of the earth. Every tree whose fruit yields seed, to you it shall be for food. Also to every beast of the earth, to everything that is in the air, to everything that creeps on the earth in which there is life, I have given every green herb for food." And it was so. Prior to the flood, what were both man and animals? According to this text, we were vegetarian. Oh, that, now that explains a whole lot. I ought to see like light bulbs going off. And the reason I say that, that helps me understand how the animals could coexist with man without us worrying about getting eaten. Because think about it. We're all vegetarian. It also helps me understand how you can get all the animals on that boat without them eating each other. They're all vegetarian. Helps me understand how Noah could get all the food needed. They're all vegetarian. In fact, it's not until Genesis 9, verse 3, right after the flood, God making his promise to Noah, that he says, "Every moving thing that lives shall be food for you. I've given you all things, even as the green herb." So basically, after the flood, God says what? Fire up the barbecue. So what happened to them? There are all kinds of theories. I'm aware of about 27 theories of what killed them. The one your kids are going to hear the most about is that asteroid. But to me, that asteroid actually causes more questions than it does solutions. How do you selectively kill one group of animals, even on the other side of the planet? I brought five of the 27 that I'm aware of. Number two, a nearby exploding star flooded the earth with intense radiation. Number three, the earth's climate became too warm, too cold, too dry, too wet for the dinosaurs' health. Number four, a change in the dinosaurs' diet resulted in weakened eggshells that broke after being laid. Sad to say, number five really is a scientific theory. A laxative plant in the dinosaurs' diet disappeared, and they all died of constipation. I will let you decide if that one's possible, probable, or pitiful. What do I think happened? Folks, I think the dinosaurs were on that boat. And I think when they came off of that boat, the earth had changed dramatically. In fact, if we had plenty of time, the next thing that I would walk you through is the fact that the flood kicked off the ice age. Limiting how far the animals can go, changing our weather patterns. So all of a sudden you have these cold-blooded creatures needing lots of vegetation. Suddenly those little warm-blooded fuzzy mammals start thriving. And yeah, I do believe the dinosaurs made it after the flood. In fact, I think the evidence I showed you tonight proves they had to have. But I'm not convinced they ever thrived again. Because if you think about it, two things happen. Number one, massive change after the flood. Number two, what has man always done to animals we fear? We hunt them, we kill them. I mean, think about this. You're Noah. 20 years after the flood, you walk out of your tent, you look out, you say, "Boys, go get us something to eat." Shem, Japheth walk out of their tents, they look, and they see a squirrel right over there. For all of you who like Pixar, squirrel. They see a possum, and they see a stegosaurus. And they look back over at that squirrel and they think, "Ah, oh, he's small, greasy, he's not going to feed all the whole family." They look at that possum and they're thinking, "Nah, we'll leave him for the people in Arkansas." I'll tell you that story maybe in a minute. He looks over at that stegosaurus and says, "We could eat on that guy for weeks." You see, folks, I think when you really start looking at the evidence, you see God's word fits the evidence around us. Here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to open it up for your comments, your questions. I realize that some of you may need to travel. It's not going to offend me a bit if you need to get up and leave. I will point out, seminar does not stop tonight. We are starting back again in the morning. I'm going to look for what time? 9:30. In fact, if you want a good seat, be here at 9:15. Some of y'all been dragging in. Y'all be here at like 9:10, okay? 9:30 tomorrow morning, we're going to talk about, I'll say this. It's my wife's favorite lesson. That's all I'm going to tell you. So if you want to hear, and she's heard most all of them, at 10:30, we're going to switch gears. We're going to get a little bit serious. And I hope to present something that you will hopefully never, ever forget. At 1 o'clock, is that correct? 1 o'clock, we're going to talk about one of the assaults on Christianity in America, and that would be Islam. So I do hope that you'll make plans to be back. If my memory serves me correctly, 2 o'clock, we've got the Frieda Hardeman chorus group that's going to be singing. Plan on being with us. If for no other reason, they're going to feed you, so you got free food. Plan on being here tomorrow. Floor is yours. Questions, comments? Right here.
Brad, you talked a minute ago at the very end about the vegetation or vegetarian animals. Put that in perspective with tigers, lions, type animals such as that, that are
typically carnivores?
Yes.
Yeah. So what about all these animals that we view as carnivorous? You know, how do we kind of harmonize that? I did a study, it's been now about 8 years ago, and discovered that two zoos, San Diego and I believe it was St. Louis Zoo, had shown, they'd actually done research showing that animals we consider carnivorous could actually subsist on fruits, berries, vegetables, without losing any of their body mass index, their BMI. So even though we constantly are thinking, hey, these are carnivorous only, we actually have scientific evidence showing they can live just fine on vegetation. So is it possible that previously their diet was X, they did fine, after the flood God says, okay, now you can eat everything, anything, and lo and behold, animals started choosing whatever was nearby, whatever was in their vicinity? I think so. I mean, we've always gravitated towards two things, a water supply and a food supply. And I think carnivorous animals have done the same thing. They basically adapted to that. Is adaptation the same thing as evolution? No. Good question.
Flying over the desert, somewhere between Indianapolis and Nevada, looking down, you could see, look like tremendous gullies and tributaries and everything. Everything dry as a bone.
Yep.
Do you have a good idea how those form with no water around?
So I do spend quite a bit of time on airplanes and have the chance to look out a lot. And you do see what he's talking about, these vast ditches, these vast craters, for lack of better words. Two things going on there. Number one, we do know that there really was an ice age, okay? And the glaciers came down. I would point out it didn't happen millions and millions of years ago, didn't last for millions of years, but rather it was kicked off by the flood. I think that's part of what you're seeing. But I also know that things have changed a lot since the flood. We've got different weather patterns, we've got different even water patterns. So during my lifetime, I've seen cycles of weather pattern changes. I can remember, you know, 2 or 3 years in a row, we'd get massive amounts of snow, massive amounts of rain, and then we'd go through a dry spell. And then the same thing would kind of happen. I think what you're seeing when you look up in the air is basically some of that exact thing, where you've got areas that used to be a lot more tropical, and now today they look very, very arid. Part of it is changes in weather patterns. Some of it may even have to do with the fact that the jet stream has moved after the flood. And so what used to be, prior to the flood, kind of this greenhouse around the earth is now no longer. I mean, I can show you fossils from the Sahara Desert. Folks, we know it used to be a rainforest. It's not a rainforest today. And the reason we know that, I mean, we know the process of desertification, how it's actually moving, it's the same exact thing that's kind of happening over here. Yes, sir.
What's your opinion about subspecies and natural selection?
Great question. So let me start by answering your question this way. Do I believe in any form of evolution? And young people, please listen to me on this one. I know microevolution is true. Okay? Microevolution is simply small changes within limited parameters. And here's what I mean by that. Can you take two dogs, breed them together, and get a different kind of dog? Yeah, we've been doing that for centuries. You know, we've got short-haired dogs, long-haired dogs, sporting dogs. But when you breed two dogs, what do you still get? You get a dog. You don't get a fern or rhinoceros. You get a dog, right? That's microevolution. It is true. We know what happens. The problem is they'll take that truth and they'll try to jump and say, oh, okay, all of these things came from a common ancestor and that you can cross species line, something we've never seen in a laboratory. So do I believe that? No. But do I believe in micro? Yeah. Good question.
Okay, I know you said that we have, like, the dinosaurs could have died out from, like, a dietary change or a climate change or some kind of, you know, man-made thing where we hunted them or something. But what? How would you explain the dying out of all the mammalian megafauna? Like the woolly mammoth and the giant ground sloth and the woolly rhino and the big horses. Like, do you think that, like you talked about adaptation, like I know that I've been told that, like, if you release a domesticated pig into the wild, that it'll grow hair and tusks like a wild hog that you find in the woods.
Feral pigs, right.
Yeah. So do you think it's possible that, like, the woolly mammoths, as the, you know, the, you said an ice age happened after the flood. If it heated up, do you think the woolly mammoths that had, like, the larger ears and the shorter tusks and the shorter hair survived? Like an adaptationary thing.
Do I think that... Ask one more time.
Like, do you think that the woolly mammoths that had, like, adaptations that make them...
Our modern-day elephants?
Yeah.
Possibly. He mentioned the fact that you take a domesticated-type pig, release it in the wild, after a while it grows hair, tusk, looks like a feral hog. Do I think the same thing could happen to an elephant? Possibly, although there are some structural differences. I basically look at it this way. If I look at a chart with all the different types of dogs, there are some of those that are no longer in existence because they've gone extinct. Are all these other things very closely related to it? Yeah. And I think the same thing with woolly mammoths, elephants, etc. Do I think they're in the same family? Yeah. Now, would I love to see them maybe do what you just said, release some, let them go? You know, to me that would be kind of a fun experiment, but I don't see that happening. Yes, sir.
Say there was a drought. Do you think the animals would migrate or go extinct?
Ah, that's a great question. So if we've got a drought, do I think the animals would migrate or do I think they would go extinct? I'm going to answer your question using the Bible to kind of point at something. If you've got a Bible, open it up to Genesis 5. Take a look at the last verse of Genesis 5 where we are informed that Noah is 500 years old, and it says he begot Shem, Ham, and Japheth. So he's 500 years old. Then he's given the instruction to build the ark. And you'll notice in Genesis chapter 7, verse 6, it says he was 600 years old when the floodwaters were on the earth. Why am I using that to answer his question? That means he's got roughly 100 years to build this boat. And if you look at the end, let's see, Genesis chapter 6, take a look with me at verse 20. A lot of people always argue, how could Noah go get these animals? And how could he get the penguins and the polar bear? If you look at verse 20, it says, of birds after their kind, of animals after their kind, of every creeping thing after their kind, two of every kind will come to you to keep them alive. Did Noah have to go get the animals? No, they came to him. Here's why I'm
using this as an example. There's some really smart guys who have suggested it might not have been miraculous for the animals to come to Noah, that God could have simply used eating and migration patterns over 100 years, drought, food, basically pushing them to where he wanted them to go to be ready to get on the ark. What do I know from being a biologist? I know that there are some animals that will simply move and go to a different place and they'll survive. They'll get more water or food. But I also know that there's some that don't, either because they can't or because maybe they don't have an instinct in them to go find something else. And so there are some animals that if you don't have a food source or a water source, that group of those creatures will die out. Now, they may be other species just like it somewhere else that will then kind of fill in for them. But yeah, that's a great question. Very good question.
I'd like to go back to the, before the dinosaurs, I'd like to go back to the pictures of the dinosaurs and okay. the five-year-old children. And the what can we do as parents besides teach the children at home this is not true? What can we do as Christians and as parents with our children being taught? Okay. I mean, it took one woman to take prayer out of school because Christians did not stand
That's
up.
Right. That's
so
right.
So what can we do to get stuff like that out
okay.
of school?
Let me first start out, thank you for asking that question, because everybody in this room needs to understand Satan's got our children in his sights. He's already got the children out there. He wants the ones in here. And so if you are a mom and dad or a grandparent, you need to be very, very aware and very active that there is a battle going on for the soul of your child. If you don't realize that, then you need to wake up quickly. What can we do? I always, always, always say start at home. That sounds very cliche and very easy, but let me tell you something. My wife and I, we live, eat, and breathe this stuff that I'm talking about to you this weekend. And occasionally, my children will come to me and go, Dad, you didn't get this book that we got in the library. It's got evolution in it. And I'm thinking, we monitor everything. How did that slip in here? So first things first, monitor things, filter things. If you're just freely letting books, videos, movies into your home, then you need to understand you're allowing the enemy in. Second thing, you need to get on the school boards. You need to support Christian teachers. You need to, any way that you can, basically make sure children are getting the right worldview, do it. Whether that means writing to your local politicians, whether that means, you know, I don't think you guys are at this point yet, thankfully, because you guys are, you have the luxury of having teachers who are probably a little bit more spiritual minded and you're a little bit more rural and you're not in Memphis, you're not in Dallas, Fort Worth. In those areas, if I was looking at parents, I would probably say start looking at alternatives, because it's gotten to the point now. Had a teacher come up to me, tears in her eyes. She looked at me, she said, Brad, I'm having to quit the job I love. I said, why are you doing that? She said, because I was just doing my evaluation. They brought in a little 5 or 6 year old boy. He was dressed in a dress, wanted to be called Sally. They brought in an evaluator to watch me to make sure I referred to him as a her all day long, female pronouns, and called him by her, Sally. All day. She said, I couldn't do it. Things like that are getting worse and worse and worse quickly, quickly, quickly. So we've got to realize that there is this battle out there going on and it's serious. The other thing I would do, I would load my child up with as much Christian evidence material as I possibly can. Because it's this kind of stuff that if you can plant in their hearts and their minds, they may not have the answer when they're a freshman in college. They may not be able to go, that's blah, blah, blah. But they at least know the answer does exist. You know, yeah, I've heard it. I joke, there's a couple of congregations, I tease them. I say they have me on retainer because they don't want any of their young people to graduate through their youth program without ever hearing a full series because they don't want them going to college without being exposed to this kind of information. So knowledge is power. Get them the truth. Yes.
You talked about the dinosaurs where they found a fresh-ish tissue, the soft tissue with blood cells and DNA. I'm kind of a sci-fi guy, and I was just wondering if it was at all possible that they could clone a dinosaur. Yes.
They are trying. I know they're trying. The reason I say they're trying, they are doing DNA sequencing. It's going to be hard because the substrate, you've got to have something to put it in. And the closest thing that we might have would be like an ostrich egg. So you got to figure out how, even if you've got a complete sequence, which that by itself is going to be a huge ordeal, took 13 years and hundreds of labs to get a complete human sequence. So you can imagine for a dinosaur, it's a pretty big deal. But even once you get that DNA, getting that DNA into a cell that will then you can then clone, putting that in an egg, we're still a little ways away from that. Yes, sir.
If you take like reptile cells and put it in a hippo, wouldn't it become a stegosaurus?
If you took reptile cells, put it in a hippo, could it become a stegosaurus? I don't know that it would become a stegosaurus so much as it would become what they call a chimera or a hybrid. And while some people in this room may kind of think that's silly, they're actually doing what you're talking about on a different scale. They're actually combining tissue from one animal and another one, splicing it together, and they're making these hybrid animals. They're actually doing it with humans too. Taking cow DNA, human DNA, splicing them together, and then allowing it to grow. Good question. Any more thoughts? Yes.
I have two questions, actually.
Okay.
The first one, was there actually really people that came from, like, Africa to across the land bridge into America?
Good question. So, I don't think I have a picture of it. Yes, that's the answer to your question, but was there an ice age? Yes. Was there a land bridge between Alaska and Asia? Yeah, we know there was. What do I think happened there? I think that's how we can explain the Native Americans, the Aztecs, the Mayans. I think once that land bridge went away, they actually were landlocked. And so only to be rediscovered, you know, hundreds of years later. But yeah, I think that's how the Native Americans, the Aztecs, the Mayans, they all got here to begin with. Good question. Other question.
Was Pangaea, like continental drift, real? Like, okay, was the question. Earth all
she,
one?
She asked about Pangaea. I always have to tell the adults in the room, that's not Panera, that's a bread company. If you've got a Bible, open it up to Genesis chapter 10. Look with me at verse 25. I'm going to give you a verse not to ever, ever use to answer her question, okay? Genesis chapter 10, verse 25, the Bible says, to Eber were born two sons. The name of one was Peleg, for in his days the earth was divided. Pangaea is the concept that there was this supercontinent, and that over time it's kind of spread out. A lot of people will point out this verse and they'll say, hey, that's what it's talking about. And I'm going, no, this is actually talking about a division of peoples. And I can prove that to you. If you want to look at, for instance, verse 5, take a look at verse 5 where it says, for these the coastland peoples of the Gentiles were separated into their lands, everyone according to what? His language. Now skip on to verse 20. These were the sons of Ham, according to their families, according to their languages. Verse 31, these were the sons of Shem, according to their families, according to their languages in their land. Let me remind you, Tower of Babel had not started yet. That's the next chapter. How many languages were around when the Tower of Babel started? One. Chapter 10 is actually looking forward. It's describing what happened post Tower of Babel.
And so when it talks about these people were divided, it's talking about, for instance, the Jews, the Palestinians, the Muslims, a division of peoples. Do I think Pangaea really happened? I'm going to give you my opinion. This is opinion, so take opinion for what it's worth. I do think that things were closer together. Here's the thing I have a problem with. When they teach it to young people in school, they'll show Africa, South America being a really good fit, and they'll say something like this. They're moving apart at a rate of 33 millimeters a year. And so they do the distance, they do the math, and they say, oh, it took a gazillion years for them to separate. What are they assuming? A constant, slow, uniform separation. Is it possible that God ripped everything apart at the flood? Like Genesis 7:11 says, on that day, all the fountains of the great deep were broke up and the windows of heaven were open. Is it possible that everything was close together and then at the flood, he starts ripping things apart? Yeah, I think so. And that's my opinion is, yeah, things were closer together. And it was the flood event that actually caused it to do that. Good question.
We saw you maybe 15 years ago, and as a young beginning science teacher, the facts that you gave really armed me and prepared me how to be a Christian in my classroom. But one of the points that stuck out to me that night, when you talked about the flood, how you mentioned that God, when the flood came, he was angry, but he only flooded the earth enough to make his point, I guess you would say. And you had mentioned the construction of the ark in Genesis 6:15, that the height was 30 cubits. And then it's mentioned in chapter 7, verse 20, that the flood was only 15 cubits above the mountains. Would you just expand on that a little?
Yeah. And let me point out, she says she heard me 15 years ago. I started this when I was 12. what she's talking about is we know that a boat sinks in the water. It's called the draft of a boat. And if you've got a speedboat, you don't want that boat sitting deeply in the water, right? You want it to scoot across very quickly. The draft of a speedboat is very, very shallow. But if you have an ocean-worthy vessel, say an oil tanker or a ship, that boat has to settle down into the water to be able to withstand the pounding waves. Now, you ask a shipbuilder, what is the draft of an ocean-worthy vessel? They'll tell you, it's one half of the height. And what that means is, you've got to have a half of that boat below the level of the water in order to keep it from capsizing. Now, she gave you the dimensions of the boat. If you want to relook them up, Genesis chapter 6, take a look at verse 15. It says, this is how you shall make it. The length of the ark should be 300 cubits, the width 50, the height 30 cubits. So if it's 30 cubits high, how much of it has to sink into the water? 15 cubits. So God has got to give this boat 15 cubits of clearance. Now think about this. If you've got a mountain that's submerged under the water, and he only puts like that much water on top of it, and the ark's floating around, and it hits the top of that mountain, and it rips a hole in it. So he's got to give him 15 cubits of clearance. Now read with me Genesis chapter 7, verse 18 and following. The waters prevailed exceedingly on the earth, and all the high hills under the whole heaven were covered. The waters prevailed 15 cubits upward, and the mountains were covered. God knew precisely how much water he had to place on those mountaintops. You know, sometimes we look at this book, and we think of it as just kind of stories, so to speak. But these were real accounts that happened. I see one hand. That I'll take one final question, then I'm going to turn it over to Larry. Yes, ma'am. Yes.
And also,
Okay. What she's talking about basically is the idea that we had a, I'm going to use the word canopy around the earth of water vapor or ice or water. If you look in Genesis chapter 1, look in verse 6 says, "Let there be a firmament in the midst of the waters, let it divide the waters from the waters. Thus God made a firmament, divided the waters which were under the firmament from the waters which were above the firmament, and it was so." Word firmament there comes from the Hebrew word rakia, and it means an expanse of the heavens. So what it sounds like you've got going on is you got water, then you've got this expanse, and then you got another layer. And it's that second layer that a lot of people look at and go, that is what happened when God, in Genesis 7:11, when it talks about where did the water for the flood come from, it says he opened the windows of heaven, that was the collapse of that canopy, which would have done several things, one of which would have cut our lifespans a lot, which happened. It would have also taken out a UV filter. All these different things. So, you know, when you look at all of this stuff together, what you start seeing is things were vastly different prior to the flood. We don't sometimes take that into appreciation. But when you really start adding it up, number one, we got the science to back it up. Number two, this book right here backs it up. So I'm going to stick around. Anybody else that's got questions, I'll be down here. You can ask me. Appreciate very, very much y'all's attention, your patience. If you don't attend here normally, I don't know that, so just come on back. If you are a preacher for another congregation, here's your job. Between now and tomorrow morning, if you'll please take a sign that says we're meeting in Boonville Church of Christ in the morning at 9:30, okay? Just put that on your door. We would love to have you back. Appreciate very, very much again you being with us.
I've got one more thing, okay. Just quickly. I know y'all ready to go. You got to hear this.
Oh.
The World War II ships.
Yes.
Talking about the Ark made me think of that. Quickly tell them about the ships.
So, how big is the Ark? 300 by 50 by 30. We know a cubit's defined as a length of a man's forearm. There is a fleet of ships called the Liberty ships that were actually built to the dimensions of Noah's Ark. There's actually one on display. I think it's Pier 39 in California, San Francisco. Heard about it long before I ever got to see it. I called down, I talked to a retired Navy guy, and I asked him, I said, what can you tell me about this boat, the SS Jeremiah O'Brien? And he told me the year it was constructed. He told me the wars it had fought in, the battles it had fought in, all these different things. And I let the guy talk for like 7 or 8 minutes before I finally asked him that one question that I wanted to know. I said, what can you tell me about its size? Now, this guy didn't know me from Adam, doesn't know what I do for a living. But the next words out of his mouth were, do you own a Bible? I said, yes, sir, I do. He said, well, if you'll open it up to the book of Genesis, you can find the dimensions for this boat. And I said, excuse me? He said, yeah, we built the whole fleet of these boats to the dimensions of Noah's Ark. I said, why did you do that? He said, because we wanted to have large ships that could carry heavy loads through rough seas. Now, folks, that's our Navy patterned a blueprint that they got from Noah, who got his from God.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I am impressed that all of you are still here at this late hour, and you just seem to be really soaking it up and interesting. Okay, I appreciate that, and all these young people especially. That's great. And there's more to come. Paul Harvey says what? The rest of the story. Tommy Barragona, will you come and lead us in a prayer? Tell me, you got 2:75. Okay. At the 6 o'clock hour, 2:75, and the 7 o'clock hour, 2:77. Is that what that is? Two? Okay, great. My prediction tomorrow, over 500. Be here to see it. We'll feed everybody in 20 minutes.
Would you bow with me, please? Father, we are so thankful we've had the opportunity to be here tonight to hear these things and to hear about how you created this world and how you sustain it. Father, we pray that you'll be with us tomorrow as we continue this series. Father, we are thankful that we are receiving this knowledge, and we pray that we can put it to use in your kingdom. These things we ask through Jesus' name. Amen.